expresses, or is capable in given contextual conditions of expressing. And to know this is just to know what we would be believing if we took that thought to be true. Now suppose we understand the basic notion of a true predication, of truly applying a concept in an individual case, the notion schematized in logic in the forms of atomic proposition. We can write these forms, as you know, and as I've done on the board, as fx, fxy, etc., where the x's and y's are placeholders for names of individuals, and the f's are placeholders for predicates. Now, of course, for this structure to have content, we must also learn the sense of individual predicates. The difference, for example, between the truth conditions for predicating is blue, and those for predicating, say, is square, or is a tiger, or something. But this will be so for any structural explanation. Formal logic, on this view, supplies the necessary structural key for an adequate semantic theory for any natural language. Now, the semantic theorist who thus takes his stand on formal logic is aware that adjustments are necessary before this key will turn. To illustrate the point with a very simple case, take the two attributive adjectives, good and bad, and an indefinite list of nouns such as hockey player, draftsman, king, husband, and so on. It seems clear that in mastering the semantic force of the two adjectives, we've also mastered a very simple rule of combination, such that, given that we also know the meanings of the relevant nouns, plus the notion of predication and conjunction, we can put the right semantic interpretation on an indefinitely large class of sentences, of which are instances, sentences 1 and 2, on the blackboard. Sentence 1, Charles is a good husband and a bad king. Sentence 2, John is a good hockey player and a bad lecturer. But now, if we turn in a naive spirit to formal logic to help us with the elucidation of the principles of our semantic understanding here, we are immediately in a dilemma. We can't treat these sentences in the spirit in which we can treat, say, my sentence number 3. John is a 38-year-old hockey player and a long-haired lecturer. With this one, number 3, we can just render it perhaps as a conjunction of 4 simple predications which could be redistributed in any order without affecting the truth value of what's said. We can treat it in effect as John is 38 years old and John is a hockey player and John is long-haired and John is a lecturer and so on. But to apply the same treatment to sentences 1 and 2 would be semantically disastrous. It would lead, for example, to the result that sentence 1 is equivalent, as regards truth conditions, to sentence 4, Charles is a good king and a bad husband. So that won't do. So in general, no simple maneuver stands the slightest chance of displaying, as subject to the structural rules of logic, all those structural features which are quite obviously at work in generating sentence meanings out of sentence elements. So the semantic theorist who follows this line, who takes his stand on logic, is bound to work hard at recasting whole classes of ordinary sentences in such a way, as he would put it, as to reveal their true logical form. And studying them in their restructured, recast form, he hopes, we shall be able to see just how just the same logical principles are really at work in determining their meanings as we see at work in those well-behaved sentences of ordinary language whose true or deep logical structure is simply mirrored in their surface appearance. And the idiosyncratic semantics and syntax of particular natural languages will, on this view, be complete when we have framed mechanically applicable rules which will enable us to transform the superficial structures of all sentences of a language into their deep or true logical forms. Well, now, this is one program, and a program to be treated with great respect. But I don't think we can say that it has an exclusive claim to be treated as the right way to set about the problem.
In this lecture we've just heard, you characterise a way of doing the semantics for a natural language, such as English, the formal logician's way of doing it, and you hint that this isn't the way you yourself think the subject ought to be pursued, though you treat it with a considerable amount of respect. Can you perhaps explain what you think wrong with doing it that way?
Well, in general, I think it's unrealistically restrictive. Let's take an example of the sort that's been discussed recently. Let's take John kissed Mary in the garden at midnight. Now, this is typical, of course, of a whole host of sentences in which we say that somebody acted in some way, sometime, some when. And part of our understanding of these sentences is knowing that, for example, John kissed Mary in the garden at midnight can be true only if John kissed Mary, period, is true. Our grasp of this logical consequence of the inference of John kissed Mary from John kissed Mary in the garden at midnight is part of our understanding of this class of sentences. This is true of the whole lot of sentences of this class. Now, it might look straight off as if our understanding of this feature of these sentences was to be explained by our having hold of a fairly simple rule. After all, it's in the nature of action that when people act, they act somewhere, sometime. So it seems we can, given an action predicate, like kissed, always modify that predicate by combining it with a locality-specifying expression, like in the garden, or time-specifying expression, like at midnight, to form a modified predicate which will be true, which will hold true, of just those agents of which the unmodified predicate, John kissed Mary, kissed, is true. We might call this form of combination adverbial modification, right? Now, here we seem to have hold of a perfectly general and perspicuous principle, our grasp of which is sufficient to account for our grasp of this general logical feature of these sentences. But if you accept the approach that I was critical of, then you can't accept this. And the reason why you can't is that the predicate calculus, that is to say, the form of logic, of current logical theory, which we're talking about, and which is regarded as the framework for semantic explanation by these theorists, the predicate calculus simply doesn't allow for this style of predicate modification. It isn't catered for in the forms of the predicate calculus. So what are the theorists of this style to do? Well, what they do is to say that we understand the logical consequence here, we understand this type of sentence, because we really understand it as of a different form from the form it superficially appears to have. And to render this different form in something like ordinary English, one might say the sentence, John kissed Mary in the garden at midnight, really has a form like this. There is a kissing which was by John of Mary, and which occurred in the garden, and which occurred at midnight.
In other words, the logician doesn't have to claim that somehow he's reporting on a stage of mental activity in providing his perhaps regimented sentences. What he really wants to say of them is that they represent, in a clearer, more perspicuous form, a form in which the possibilities of inference, of entailment and so on are more clearly realized, and in another way, more clearly related to other forms of inference, they represent these better than the ordinary English sentences themselves.
Well, of course, by talking of a process, I didn't mean to saddle him with the suggestion that we actually went through this process, only that it was, so to speak, available to us. Even if this is made quite clear, why is it that we, as it were, go so remote, so far from the explicit, from the forms that we really understand them to have, and instead, as it were, mask them as having a form that they, on his view, don't?
Well, he might point out the way language has been built up. It wasn't built up like a French city with, or an American city, for that point of view, with the streets laid out before. It's built up like a very ancient city. There's a long history, and bits are added on here and there, fashion.